is what? A spirit, possesses a soul, live in a body. The soul which the mind is part of came into existence by the connection between the spirit and the body and Adam. When the earth connects with the spirit, it brings what we call a soul. And so the Bible says man become what? A living soul. So the soul has this tendency to add things towards the spirit or things away from the spirit to the body. Am I communicating? Going somewhere? So Paul will say, the problem is not the soul. Most of the time, the problem is the body, because the body is from the earth. Amen. But if the soul is the gateway of the spirit, that is to say that if I'm going to preserve the soul, I need to present the thing that the soul can easily lean on as a living sacrifice, so that when my body is in alignment with the will of God, my whole body becomes whole to God. Am I communicating? So it says, present your body a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. In verse 2, it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be ye what? Transformed. By what? By the renewing of the mind. The body is already presented. That now allows the soul to be transformed so as to give great and good information to the spirit. Does it make sense? Why are you saying this? Man is a talking spirit. Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. It says, and God made another speaking spirit. That is to say that for man to be effective, he must speak. A man that cannot speak will be deprived of his power. Am I communicating here? Man is what? A speaking spirit. If man is another speaking spirit, then the first speaking spirit we know is God. So, and God says in chapter 1, verse 26 of Genesis chapter 1, 26, he says, and God says, let us make man in our own image. What is the image of God? God is a speaking spirit. Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. Hebrew.
Any of them is good. We would have done another one called Shibru. Amen.
Man is what? Another speaking spirit. Because God is what? God is the first speaking spirit. Talking about the law of confession. What you confess is what you possess. So look at verse number 3. Of Hebrews chapter 1, who being in the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, Opposing all things by the power of his word. Sorry, by the word of his power. He's talking about Jesus, who being the brightness of his glory, the express image of his person, talking about God the Father. And in describing him, he says that upholding all things by the word of his power. Is a speaking God. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 3, we understand that the world was framed by the word of God. The world was framed by the word of God. So God is what? A speaking spirit. John chapter 1, verse number 1. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. Is a speaking spirit. The first introduction of God, like we saw in Genesis chapter 1, verse 3, it says, verse 1 says, and God created the heavens and earth. Verse 2, and the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, but the Spirit of God moves upon the surface, upon the face of the deep. Verse 3, and God said, if God did not speak, the earth would have remained void. It's a speaking spirit. The way God carries out his intention is by speaking. Am I communicating here? Not by whining, not by complaining, it's by speaking. God never speaks any negative word. Have you seen God speaking negative, something negative? The earth was without form, void. Like we have confusion in our lives. But God's own way is that I will not speak what I see. I will only speak what I desire. Why? Because it's a speaking spirit. God's power is in his word. Can I repeat that? That God's power is in his word. That's why he said, I honor my word more than my holy name. And you are made in his image. Exactly the way he operates. Am I communicating? Think about it. If everything he does through words. Everything God does is through the release of words. There's nothing he did without speaking. Jesus was going to heal, he speaks. You think you will keep your mouth quiet and things will work? It will not. Why? You are a speaking spirit. Communication. So what you speak matters. Go, let's go to Matthew. Please get the tape. First service, get the tape. I don't want to. You know, my wife will always tell me you waste all your time for repeating yourself, and your time is gone. In Matthew chapter 12, verse number 33, that's where we stopped in the morning service. Please get the morning service if you are not here. Please, I beg you, it will help you. It will help you. This is the direction that this God is taking us through. He wants us to become a speaking being. What that is saying is that you are going to be powerful on your own. Can I yell out, amen? Because the word of God carries power. power and authority is released through words. How much of the word you have will determine how much power you carry. How much power under your influence. No wonder Jesus was powerful. He is the word itself. We are a spirit speaking being. You know why most of us fall into temptation? You know why most of us could not resist the devil? It's because we try to resist it by our word. Am I communicating? You see Jesus. It is written. It combats the enemy by spoken words. It countered the word of the enemy by spoken words. Why? Because we are another spirit being, another speaking spirit being. You say, Pastor, I'm just coming to know that. No, you've known that for a long time. Because your life is a framework of all your confessions. You are your confessions. The things you have confessed about you is who you are. You are the product of your confession. Hallelujah. Matthew chapter 13. Oh, Jesus is Lord. Are you getting something out of this? I pray God write this in the table of your heart. I pray that this word will not leave you. As you journey through life, the Holy Ghost will constantly remind you that you are the spirit being. You are another speaking spirit. You are not just ordinary man, but you are a speaking spirit. That you should take note of the word you release. You should place value in your words. We must place value in our words. Difference between Jesus doing miracles and you and me today is that most of the time we don't place value in our words. Why? Because we never thought that we're a speaking spirit. But we are. Because the negative things we speak about ourselves, they're coming to pass. Oh, yes. Because negative things are coming to pass. Oh, I'm dead. Oh, my head is killing me. Oh, this is hurting me. Oh, I'm broke. Oh, this is happening. My family, oh my God, my marriage is just worse. Oh my God, this is going on. My children, all the things that we've been speaking and voicing out. Guess what? We are eating the fruit. Oh, I'm so frustrated. Oh, yeah? That's what we're getting? I'm depressed. Oh, here we come. I don't feel happy. Healed will come. Why? Because you're a speaking spirit. You've just given order. Give me. Okay, let me not jump. I just want to do it. Let's take it step by step. So, Matthew chapter 12, verse 33. Matthew 12, verse 33. If you're there, say amen. Let me do from verse 35. And a good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth what? Good three things. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth what? Evil things. But I say unto you that every idle words that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Who is speaking? Who? Oh, was he joking? No. But why would Jesus say so? The reason is you are known by your word. You are your word. Have you seen a person that is a liar?
We all know people that are liar. Even sometimes we lie. We think that person is a liar, but we are the one doing the lie. Have you seen human beings? Human beings are very funny. They always see it from their own point of view. That person is a liar. But they are the one lying. Anyway, let's leave that alone. Trying to drive it home. Trying to make sense of what I'm going to say. Bear with me. Okay, got it.
So, somebody comes and says, did you see that brother? He's a liar. Why do you call him liar? Because his words are lie. Am I communicating? So, you are your words. You are identified by words. Think about it. Think about it. Why do you call person? You look at a person and say, that guy is a liar. No. Because him and his word is one. It is his word that defines him. Your word defines you. Where you are right now is the product of your confession. What you have confessed about yourself, about your family. Oh, my family is bad. My husband, bad. My wife, oh my God. Devil itself. Guess what? You are marrying devil. She's going to act devil. Because you just called her. Oh, my boss, wicked. Guess what? He's going to be wicked. A man shall eat out of what? The fruit of his lips. Watch what you say. Because they will form. They will take shape. Okay, what he says? It says, man will give account of every idle word. What are idle words? Idle words are useless words. Idle words are negative words. Idle words are words that we just speak carelessly. But Jesus is saying that, no, you did not misspoke. Even though you think you misspoke, I will judge you by it. You know what Jesus is saying? It's not only saying that in the day of judgment, the judgment seat of Christ will be judged by it. No, he's talking about that. But guess what? He's saying that what you speak are seeds, they will grow. They will produce. They will bring harvest. The harvest will judge you. When men see the harvest in your life, I don't want to be part of this. Because you have spoken it. My family. Nobody prospers my family. Everywhere you go to, you say that. Becomes your testimony. Bad things happen in our family. Can you imagine? This devil is just harassing us in our family. And you are born again. And it's harassing you. You have the Holy Ghost. And devil is harassing you. And you have the audacity to speak it out. Am I speaking to people here? Say to your neighbor, may God touch your tongue. So, idle words are what? A careless word. A word that is not in alignment to the will of God for your life. And verse 35, it will say, for by words, by thy words shall thou be what? Justify. That word justify simply means by your word you will be acquitted. By your word, you shall be what? Justified. Or condemned. Word there condemns also means put in bondage. Making sense? By what? By the things you say, you shall be justified, acquitted, set free, allowed to reign, or you shall be condemned. Guess what? Put in bondage. In Matthew chapter 13, verse number 10 and 11, Jesus there was talking about why he speaks to the people in by mysteries. Okay, let's settle some matter here. Man's problem is not money or the devil, but his confession. The devil has no power to stop you from accomplishing. No, he has no power. He has no power to stop any human being. The only one that has power to stop you is you. That is how God has wired it. That's why he says a man shall eat of the fruit of his lips, not of another man's fruit. Amen. Amen. So in Genesis, like we've all read before, 1:26, man was made in the image of God. So man operates through words because we are spirits. We operate like God. God operates through words. God will say to Moses, as the people have said in my ears, that is what I'm going to do. I'm a God that operates through words. That's the reason why if you come in and says, Lord Jesus, I receive you, your confession, he grabs it because man operates through words. Have you thought about it? Just simple confession and that's it. Words. That's who we are. That's who you are. You are a spirit being. And so if man operates through words, what have been your confession thus far? What have you been speaking over your life? Death or lie? It is not the devil, it's you. It is your full confession. The Bible says, where we read Hebrews chapter 1, verse number 3. It says, he opposed all things by the word of his power. Listen to that scripture again. Can you give me that scripture? Okay. He opposed all things by what? By the word of his power. Not the power of his word. But by the word of his power. Now, I was able to Google this. I can't tell you right now because I tried to do it. Reading that verse and trying to prove it scientifically. That the scientist actually says that the world is still expanding. The universe is still expanding. Hello? The universe. Why? Because the world has been released. My word will not return to me void. It must continue till he accomplish. So every word, if God's word, he says he upholds all things through the word of his power. If the universe, as big and massive as the universe is still expanding till tomorrow, just by the word of God. Hello? What are you speaking to yourself? Number two matter that we must resolve before we move forward. God is the first speaking spirit, and you are the second speaking spirit. Mark chapter. Don't open the Bible. Let me tell you a story. But I don't have time. Remember Jesus finished his crusade and told his people, let's go to the other side. Please listen to me. This will help us. What the Lord told me is, teach this. Don't preach it. So I'm going to take time to go through scriptures to make points so that you can get it. Because the moment you get that you are a speaking spirit and you are able to bridle your tongue, there is nothing on earth that you cannot reach. There's nothing on earth. There's no one. There's nothing that can stop you. It's only you. So if we can control this tongue to speak like God speaks. So in Mark chapter 4, so Jesus was going with this book. The Bible says that he was sleeping. Hello? What did he do? Guy was tired. Slept. Took a very... I do that a lot. When I'm traveling, I adjust my head on the
on the airplane seat. I'm ready to take off. As the plane is taking off, I'm taking off. And as God so made me wonderful, anytime they are bringing food, my eyes open. Never miss any food. No. Don't pass me by, Holy Spirit. I must grab this one. I don't know, for some reason, anytime they are bringing food, my eye will just open and say, thank you, Jesus. I can't carry less. So, Jesus was busy sleeping. And there was turbulence. Remember the story? And he stood up and says, peace be still. Am I right? And we read downward. The disciples were astonished. But he was not surprised. Because it was a natural thing. He had value for his word. If our words are going to mean anything in the realm of the spirit, we must put value on our word. You know how you put value on your word? You don't just speak anyhow. You mean what you are saying. And you say exactly what you mean. Satan, back off. In the name of Jesus. It is written. His disciples were astonished. You know the difference? Understanding. Jesus understand who he was. He was a speaking spirit. The disciples did not. It came to another point that Peter got a glimpse of what that means. Remember the story of Peter? He got a glimpse. He had Jesus say, the next time, there was turbulence again. And Jesus was walking. Remember the story? And Peter said, and he said, what? This guy is serious. And he said, Jesus, is it you? Jesus said, yes, me. If it is you, bid me to come. What? And Jesus says, come. So Peter stepped out, what? At the voice of Jesus. He says, I am coming. He started walking. Man, it's a speaking spirit. What are you looking for? What are you believing God for? Speak it. So we just sang. You are a speaking spirit. Don't just say anything anyhow. You are what? A speaking spirit. Don't describe your situation. Prescribe it. Oh, Pastor, wait, let me tell you the Genesis. I don't need Genesis. I'm already in Revelation. You know how long it's going to take you from Genesis to Revelation? You have to go through the 66 book. I'll be waiting for you to describe your situation. Let's prescribe it in the Revelation. I'll tell you the Genesis. You don't need the Genesis. Just speak the word. Say to your neighbor, just speak the word. Doesn't matter what your family has been through, just speak the word. In the process of describing it, you complicate it. God is not interested in your description. Have you seen anyone that Jesus healed and say, come, tell me what happened? Have you seen it? No. Have you seen it? That he comes and say, please tell me your history. But no! He speaks the word. If he is the first speaking spirit and we are the second speaking spirit and we are made in his image, we must operate. If we're going to succeed on planet Earth, because he succeeded on planet Earth, we must find out what he did. And one thing I found out that Jesus did, he was a speaking spirit. Have you seen just explaining things? No. He speaks. Remind me of the guy on John chapter
John chapter 5.
At the pool of Bethesda.
The guy was trying to explain. Jesus said, I'm not interested in your explanation. What do you want? You want to be healed? Go read it.
God, you know my family. You know where I'm from, God.
It is not the length of prayer that gets God's attention. It is the scripture in the prayer.
Oh, may God help us. Number 3. Matter that we must resolve. Your world is the totality of you. Your confession frames your future.
Psalm 39, verse 1. Are you getting something out of this? Are you sure? Please, it's not for you to just hear it. It's for you to do it. It is in the doing that we are going to be really successful. Amen. Watch your word. Psalm 39, verse number 1.
I just feel they have it.
Psalm 39, verse number 1. If you are there, say a big amen. I'm going to bring out something that we're going to pray about as we journey through these 10 days of prayer and fasting. Verse number 1. I say I will take heed to what? To my way. That I sin not with my tongue. I would take heed to my ways that I sin not with my tongue. I will keep my mouth with what? A padlock. Why the wicked are before me. Every time you make a negative statement, there are demons and Satan around.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes. Remember Jesus, I shared that in the first service. Jesus says, whosoever will confess me before men, I will confess him before the Father. The same is what Sam is understanding. He says, I will not sin with my tongue. I will put a padlock in my mouth, lest when I'm around the wicked.
A man is snared by the word of his mouth. When you begin to make those confessions, negative confessions about your life, the wicked is there, he grabs it.
Did you hear what that Christian sister said? He says she's depressed. Send depression. She already said it because you have opened the door. By your word, you have opened the door. Oh, poor me. He said, did you hear what she says? She says she's poor. Bring poverty. Bring frustration. Am I communicating here? So the psalmist says, I will be careful what I say because the wicked are around. They will carry my word. Words are spirit. They only make contact with spirit.
So Job chapter 6, verse 24. Close with it. Am I over preparing?
Look at what Job says. In preparing this message, I'm beginning to find out, and I'm still doing the research on the people that have great problem in the Bible and those that have great success in the Bible. And I begin to trace what they say and what their words are. Find out with Job that Job's problem was not Satan and God. Job was the one that opened the door. Job's affliction was caused by Job alone. But God was aware.
Where are you getting that from? Look at the Bible.
Because if he did not realize where his problem is coming from, he will not say this. Look at what it says in verse 24. Teach me. Teach me, and I will hold my tongue. That means his tongue has been a problem.
The first scripture we read. Help me bridle what? So that when the wicked are passing, they don't pick my word.
Job now says, teach me please, God. I know I'm now understanding why those calamities came. Because later on you'll find out in Job. He says, teach me and I will hold my tongue. And cause me to understand wherein I have erred.
And later on, we don't have time. We would have gone to Job, the later part of Job, when God begins to communicate and told Job, do you understand the ordinance of the universe?
So in Job chapter 3, we'll find out why Job was praying this prayer. Because Job chapter 3, we'll later on find that Job says, what I feared most has happened to me. So while his children were still alive, while his business was still blossoming, all Job was thinking is, this thing will crash one day. This thing can crash one day. This thing can crash one day. This thing can, something can happen. Something bad can happen. Guess what? Not every thought that comes through you belongs to you. Majority of them are just a trap of the enemy for you to think it, because he knows that your mind is the gateway to the spirit. The moment you own it, not every thought you think is yours. In fact, majority of them are not yours. They are just a trap. Amen. Amen. Not every thought is yours. You don't have to repent on your thoughts. They're not yours. It's the one you own. The moment you grab it in and begins to digest it and begins to think it, then the next thing is what?
They weren't yours. The devil just planted it. It was a seed he planted. If you will own it. But what Jesus will do, the first speaking spirit will say it is written.
Will counter that thought with the word of God.
So Job says, what I feared most. What are you afraid of? Yeah. Afraid of marriage? You are afraid of taking a step to do business? You are afraid of many things. What are you afraid of? What are you afraid of? What I feared most is exactly what came upon. One prayer I prayed for myself. God, give me boldness. To confront every challenge that comes my way. Not to succumb to it. David was anointed. His anointing did him no good till he killed Goliath. You can carry oil on your head, not until you begin to release the word of God. Everything you have is just Baba. You are a speaking spirit. God is speaking spirit. Lastly, you cannot outlive your words of confession. These are matters that we have to deal with before we go into the real laws of confession. You can't outlive your confession. They will always live. They are generational bound. Everything you are saying, God is hearing it, is recording it. Remember the story of those 10 pastors? And Moses sent 12 pastors to go and spy the land. 10 came back and said, "Oh, we saw the land. The land is beautiful. Just the way God said it. But we are grasshoppers. We are grasshoppers. We are bread. They're going to eat us." You are laughing. Is that not what you're saying? Is that not what you're saying to your life? I am an immigrant. Is that not what you're saying? Is that not the excuse you are giving to yourself for not making it? That's the excuse you are giving to yourself. Oh, poor me. I'm a single mother. That's an excuse you're giving to yourself. So that was what they were saying.
Anarchy are there. The devil's eyes. We are just ordinary people. Just an ordinary sister in the church. No power. I depend on pastor for prayer. No! Who are you? You are the daughter of God. Your destiny is in your hand. It's in your mouth. And they came with an evil report. 10 pastors.
We can't.
The food is good. How would the food not be good if there are giant there? They must have been eating good food. You want to go to the high place where everywhere is cozy, and you think you will meet people with kwashokos? Slim people? People that are weak? No, they are fed. The place you are intending to go to, which is higher, the people you are going to meet there to dispossess, they are going to be stronger. Am I communicating here? But
it's not about you. It's about the word of God, which is over you. That word.
That is the word Joshua says and Caleb. Hush! If God said it, yes, there are giants here. Yes, they are so powerful. But if the word of God says it,
let's go now.
Why communicating?
What can't you do? You know what I'm going to teach again?
Pray for me that God gives me utterance and insight. You need to pray for me and pray for the pastor that God gives us insight.
I'm going to be teaching. I pray God help me.
I was too loaded with information in this school that I went to for 3 days or 4 days. To this school. I've come to understand there are title deeds that the cross already purchased for us. Title deed of healing.
Now faith is a substance of things hoped for, and the title deed.
So we're going to talk about the title deeds. I don't know when. The different title deeds. So that you can walk into your inheritance. Because it takes understanding to walk into it.
And guess what? After some time, they now, they took stone, they wanted to stone Joshua and Caleb. I don't know how they dodged. They saved their life another day. And the people complained. Go and read Numbers 13 and 14.
Oh, can we make a captain and take us back to Egypt? We need to go back to Egypt. We can't understand this. We need to go back. Those are pastors going back to Egypt. now went again, took it to the next level. This God wants to kill us in the wilderness, kill our children, kill our wives. This wicked God wants to kill us in this wilderness. And the Bible says, and God had it. It's a speaking spirit. He had their speech. They called Moses. Moses, come. Come, 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 come. I'm going to finish this guy. See, as they have spoken in my ear, so will I do. Everyone 20 years above will not see the promised land except Joshua and Caleb. What is the difference between Joshua and Caleb and the remaining 10 pastors? It's not about holiness. It's about the confession that they confess. What are you confessing? Are you among the 10 pastors that came and says this land is too hard? Nobody can succeed. The economy is too bad. Are you among those? Or are you standing on the word of God? God, I am a tither, and the reward of a tither is that you will open the windows. Am I communicating here? You are taking God's word back to him. God, I am a faithful giver. Therefore, Lord, everyone that gives always get an increase. Are you basing your confession on what is going on? Or you are standing on the efficacy of the word of God? That scripture that cannot be broken. The infallible word. You can be anything. It starts with your mouth. It starts with your confession. You can be healed now by your confession. You can get your miracle now by your confession. You can get your breakthrough now by your confession. How valuable are your words? How much value did you have in your word that when you speak it, you are waiting to see it? Good Peter. Words. Peter, catch fish. Look, chapter 5, verse 5. I've told all night, no fish. May God bring us to this place. May God bring us to this place that we begin to understand we are speaking spirits. That all we need to do, all God is waiting for us to do. We are waiting for God, but God is waiting on us. Speak the word only. Jesus had this understanding. That was why he did. The reason why, it's not because he's a son of God. No, he did it because he understands. He said, what I see the Father do, that's what I do. And so, Peter, catching the net. That's it. Which net? I thought all night, I'm a professional fisherman. Union bound. You're telling me to you, preacher, what have you got to do with fishing? You know fishing. I know fishing. You don't know fishing. He remembered how he walked on the sea. He remembered how this man speak to the weather. It was his word. He didn't call for a prayer meeting. He didn't call for 3 days fasting and praying. He has groomed himself. Remember Elijah. A man subject like we are. Spoke. A speaking spirit. Leave Jesus alone. What about Elijah? At my word there will be no rain. He walked away. The word is your mouth. The word is your mouth. Call it. Don't doubt. is that your word? And they put the fish. Normally, fish runs away. Do you know why they catch at night? The fish will swim into the net unknowingly. Now, in the day, they don't fish because the fish will see the net. Now, when he spoke that word, the fishes in that ocean were running to enter the net. Not because he's God. He had a command of word. He knows the power that the Spirit carries. That life and death are in the power of the tongue. That anyone that loves them will eat the fruit thereof. You will eat of that fruit. If you cannot show yourself, bring yourself to that level. The way it starts is you consuming the word of God. Jesus never did anything outside God.
Confession was based on the word of God. How much of the word? This is my worry. And he has dealt with it. I shouldn't say it's my worry. If we're going to operate, you guys must be a lover of the word. Bible study must be a thing you run to grab words. To chew words. Do you know? I remember those days when we were young. There is this kind of sponge. Is that what they call it here? Okay, sponge. The one that suck up the water. When you put that sponge on the water and you bring it up, well, guess what? It's loaded. When you press it, what comes out? Water. Let us be loaded with the word that when the enemy comes and press you, God says the Lord, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. When the enemy comes and says, you are going to be bankrupt, no, God shall supply all my need according to his riches in glory. When the enemy comes and says, it looks as if you are going to come in contact with cancer, no, God has given me divine health. He said, by his stripes, I am healed in the name of Jesus. Because when they press you on every corner, what comes out is what? God says the Lord, it is written, it is written, it is written. Not complaining, it is written. Not waiting for explanation. It is written. May God bring us all to this place where the word of God becomes our food. Oh, meditate on it day and night. Everything that comes out of our mouth is the word. Oh, is the word. No negative thing is the word. It is written. I am a child of the kingdom. I am the head and not the tail. When they say no job for you, you say, no, I am the head and not the tail. No good thing will he withhold for them that love him. I am a lover of God, so nothing good can be withheld from me. I was young, I'm now old. Never seen the righteous beg bread or seed.
It's thought for me is good. You think of being depressed, all you say, God is too good. It thinks about me even now. I know the thought I have for you, thought of good. Guess what? All these things I've just said, that's the kingdom. That's how to operate in the kingdom. But to get into the kingdom, we must make the first confession. And the first confession is that we must confess Jesus as our Lord. I don't know who is here. Here in this world, as good, as nice as this world will be, or as this world is, there's only one person that makes it that way. His name is Jesus. Bible calls him the word of God. In Revelation chapter 19, verse number 13, I saw, he is the word of God. And it's ready here. He will take you in. The first confession is that you must receive Jesus. As we stand on our feet, is there anyone here that wants to give his life to Jesus?